It's time for the Giz Wiz with man's maddest rider, Dick DeBartolo. This is episode 1995, recorded Thursday, November 3rd, 2016. They drone on. On this episode of the Giz Wiz, it's a brand new month, so it's a brand new crappy theme, and Dick has three gadgets from the PhotoPlus Expo. All coming up next on the Giz Wiz!
It's the show with Dickie D and OMG chat on your PC. It's time for the Giz Wiz because gadgets are his business. They've got a gizmo sickness, geek disease,
under pathology,
rows and rows of USBs, growing blue and LEDs. Get ready for the Giz Wiz now.
Now! It is time for the Giz Wiz, and here he is, the savant of gadgets,
wow.
Dick DeBartolo. How you doing,
Dickie? I think in 2 years, I don't think we have ever used the word savant.
Savant, no.
Savant.
Maybe
wow.
Idiot savant, not savant.
No, I think idiot, yes. Exactly.
The idiot.
Exactly.
Idiot has been used to describe the show, yes.
Yes,
absolutely.
Mainly by our fans, surprisingly.
I know. And our iTunes reviews. Very interesting.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
And plural, so that neither one of us would be left out.
No, yeah. Idiots. Idiots, savants. No, just idiots. Okay. How you doing, Dickie D?
I'm doing good. What I love most about technology is that you can use stuff all week long. I reboot everything just before air. And then just as we go on, I say to you a minute before we went live, I said, how come there are only two people in the chat room?
He
said, there are 53. And then I realized that that computer had crashed. And then a minute earlier, we had a problem with Skype. And you said, I'll correct it. And when you called me back, the minute you called me back, my Skype crashed. So, and then I'm looking over at the live camera. These are three different computers.
Yeah. You
using
think.
Two different Wi-Fi systems. And two of the three of them are down right now.
You would think that over time things would become less buggy and less crashy.
Yes, you would.
That's not what happens.
But you would be wrong.
No. I feel like every time I get a new phone, I kind of feel like, okay, well, this is the phone that's just going to work perfectly, that I'm never going to have any problems with. And a week in, it's like, well, that app crashed. Okay, well, this crashed. Part of me wonders if it's because so much is built on top of legacy and then also there's so much new. So you have all these new things talking all these old things. I don't know. I don't know what it is. It doesn't seem like anything ever just works all the time.
Yeah, I know. And also, I used to have a monitor that I could mirror the one I'm talking to you with. Because when I hold up something to camera, it blocks my view of my screen.
Right.
And so I have a monitor next to it so that I can look over there to make sure that you're seeing what I want, what details. So now Windows 10 Anniversary.
Ooh, Anniversary Edition.
Oh, do you know about that? That's a big Windows 10 update.
Yeah.
That pretty much everybody, right. So it has overridden the Display Link software.
What?
Yes. So Display Link said, we are working with Microsoft.
Microsoft got rid of more things in this update. They just stripped all sorts of stuff out. Webcams wouldn't work. The display stuff is broken.
Yes. So now when you go into display, it says you can either extend it right or left, but you cannot mirror this display. And that we're working on it, and in the future, we hope to bring that feature back.
This is.
Yeah,
it was working. It was working. Why?
I know.
That's so frustrating.
I know. On the other hand, sometimes I think, I wonder how many combinations of things there are when you take into account all the programs that can run on a computer.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And all the variations of them. You know, when I got into computers back in Atari days, and believe it or not, back then, every program got to determine how the keys worked. For example, cut and paste in one program could be a totally different way that another word processor wanted to use cut and paste. So at least Microsoft got some rules going that everybody had to be using the same basic things, copy, paste, all that. But the other variations are, I assume, astronomical.
I know. I mean, it used to be that really your operating system was just to load a program. You know, it was it was there so that you could load something, and that was about it. But now, I can't imagine. I really just can't imagine starting brand new and trying to learn everything. You know, that's so impossible. It's so impossible.
It would be. It would be. Oh, man. Anyway.
And then we have, like, little minor issues that I'm just like, why can't this, why is this broken this way? This seems fixable. And little do I know, there's literally tens of thousands of code that could, anywhere in that, could be the issue that I'm having. So, it's impossible, says Stinger. Hey, let's jump into some gadgets.
Okay, we will. All right, so, the show is called PhotoPlus Expo, and it's at the Javits Center here. And it's geared toward the heavy-duty camera user. Very few. Matter of fact, I don't think saw anybody there showing camera phones. A lot of wedding photographers go to these events. The good thing is that years ago, it was only heavy-duty cameras. But now we're at least getting fun accessories. And I did find at the Ricoh booth a new version of their Theta camera. And I thought we'd start by showing. So this is a kind of, not an update, but almost a downgrade of the Theta SC. And we can just show a little bit of video there. So this was introduced about a year ago, September of last year. And so I'm standing in Times Square. And you just stand there and you just push the shutter button and then you use the mouse and you can see in any direction you want. You can go up and see the tops of the buildings and you're in the picture too. There's the only there where my fingers are closed is where the camera is. The camera is so thin. The only thing it can't shoot is itself. So at PhotoPlus, I saw the people from Ricoh. And they said, well, we have a new version now called the Theta SC. And basically they said, you're not losing any of the quality of the video. It uses the same lenses. It's still about 14 megapixels. It shoots, it still shoots video. The only two changes we've made is the S version can shoot 25 minutes of 360 video. And the new version just shoots 5 minutes of 360 video. I'm thinking, in a way, anytime someone has lent me a 360 camera, you tend really not to shoot a lot of video.
Right. This is kind of like, hey, here we are.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And then we're going to stand here, and now we're going to run the mouse all the way around it, et cetera. And they took out one other thing, and that's that the new version, there was a micro SD port on the bigger version, so you could live stream the 360 video. So they took that out of the new version. So all the optics are the same. The resolution is the same, but they knocked it down by $50. I think they were trying to get it under get a version under $300 to get.
Oh, may have lost you. Of course, we always have technical difficulties. But yeah, this is interesting. Let's wait to get Dick back here. Momentary. Moment, 1 second. Let me add a comment into our document. Insert comment. What time code? 22:31. And there he's gone. Poor guy. We lost him. Comment. Okay. Call dropped. Let's see if we can crash his computer this time as we call him.
I know. Was it you, right? Wasn't it?
No, I don't know. It seemed like both of us at the same time. Nothing crashed on my side, but...
Oh, okay.
But I have it in the notes to edit this out. So
okay, very good.
Take it away whenever you want.
Yeah. So it was a way to get more people, I think, into shooting 360 video. And as I said, it's a very small, compact camera. So if you're interested, Leo happens to love his. I don't know if he's changed his mind since a year ago. But when I talked about it, he said, oh, I got to get this. And he did shoot stuff with it. But by now, I have no idea where he is with 3D photography.
So the new one with the less features is, did you say $50 less?
$50 less. And it shoots just 5 minutes of 360 video, and you can't live stream with it. Outside of that, the optics are the same, and the resolution is the same.
So, wow. Okay, so the Theta SC under C. $200.
Under $300.
$300. Sorry, I saw the $299 and jumped. Under $300 for a 360 camera. By the way, I was reminded of something as you were talking, how the Theta S records 25 minutes and the Theta C does 5. Have you ever gotten a camera and it records video, but it stops at the 30-minute mark?
No, but I have heard of that.
Right. And
there's some sort of a file system limit. Yes.
Right. And this happens with DSLRs a lot, where you can shoot amazing, gorgeous footage on a DSLR, but you're always capped at 30 minutes recording time. And do you know why?
Because I'm going to say that your friends are bored silly after 29 minutes.
Exactly, right. No one wants to watch longer
than
30
minutes. Go ahead. Tell me the real reason.
The tax code limits a photo camera to 23 minutes or 29 minutes. If it goes beyond that, then it is considered not only a picture camera, but also a video camera, and will get taxed differently. And so they are avoiding a tax by limiting the record time to under 30 minutes, which is just ridiculous. I have been stung by this many times when I'm trying to record a long panel at a convention, when we're recording a podcast, where you hit record, you run to the other side of the camera, and then it shuts off after 30 minutes. And that is all because camera companies are avoiding paying that extra tax, from what I understand.
Oh, okay. It's very funny.
Ah!
Yes. It's very funny because dinghies at a marina, I was always saying, why does everybody just have a 9.9 horsepower motor? And so I was looking it up, and it turns out that most states require an outboard to be registered if it's 10 horsepower or higher. So
wow.
They make tons of 9.9 horsepower engines.
Oh, my gosh.
For people who don't want to have to go through the hassle.
The ultralight category.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. Well... Yeah. The thing is,
I
would pay extra if I knew that I could record past 30 minutes, because I've been stung by it so much. I wonder how much it costs. I wish they gave you the option, but they don't. Anyway, fun fact about some gadgets. I guess
yes,
let's move
exactly.
on.
Okay, we'll move on to Joby. You know Joby?
Joby, don't they create the harness? They have those crazy pods that kind of wrap around stuff, and... I remember recently I got one that would stick to a window with a cool suction cup.
Yes, exactly.
I love their products. By the way, they're based out of Petaluma.
I know. It's very funny because when I at the show, I said, oh, Joby, you guys are in Petaluma. And the guy who was a fan of Twit said, well, now Twit is within walking distance.
No way!
Of Joby.
No way.
And they introduced a neat kit. And the guy also represents Lopro. So we'll get to see two products at one time.
Perfect. Let's jump in.
Hey, Dick DeBartolo, man's maddest writer, and the Giz Wiz, One Take Theater here at gizwiz.tv. We're at PhotoPlus Expo, and we're looking around for new gadgets. We see Joby. We love Joby. You know, they make those bendable tripods, lots of neat stuff. And I found a new gadget, not John. John is an old gadget. But John is going to tell us about the new Joby gadget, which is called...
It's the POV kit. So first off, a shout out to you, man. It's an honor to be standing next to you. So
is that it? That's all you're going to say about me? No. Okay. Back to the product.
Volumes I could speak. Don't make me mad.
And pun.
Yeah, that's right. So what's amazing about this is that Joby's been in the really selfie stick in the early iteration of this for years. We made it to where it's a little bit more user-friendly. So you can actually hold it in your hand in one mode. You could actually compact it and hold it this way. Makes it a little more universal in that it's got a Bluetooth feature on it here as well, which is outstanding. So it allows you a little bit more activity, getting out there, being more active with it. It also has a stand down here for a lamp. Allows you to light your...
Wow, this is great.
And even more so as it fits all different shapes and sizes of phones. So it's adjustable, locks into place, so it's a really lockdown unit. You'll find this at all the top retailers, photo retailers, and also in a couple weeks, Apple worldwide. So it's pretty fantastic.
That is great. You know, we're using a very small selfie stick, but this is even smaller than that, and we have a Galaxy 6, which should fit in there really easily.
Yep, absolutely. And what's fun about the packaging here kind of highlights just real quickly all the features that it has. It's also a viewing station, so it's got a nice little backer area that allows it to hang on there. So,
Matt, Lopro. I do not recognize any of these bags.
One of the hottest new categories, especially as far as a conversation, is on the drone side. So you have
there are drones here.
There are drones here, which is cool. So you have the traditional drones that you can buy and learn to fly and so on. We have those versions in universal cases that are anywhere from $89 up to $250. On this side, what you're looking at, these are what they call the professionals, so the POV, personal flight, where they wear the actual goggles, and they're out there flying. Huge category, much younger demographic, and what's fun is we're pulling in the gamers now into actually flying and customizing their own POVs and flying. So
now is this line brand new or has it been out a while?
Yep. The category down below, we've been out there for about a year and a half, and now we just updated the brand new POV. So the first
to the really expensive drones.
Exactly.
And give me a price range from low to high.
If you were to buy a traditional drone, you're everywhere from $89 all the way up to $250. If you're doing a POV, you're custom building your own craft. And then over here, we customize it to where it's a workstation up on top. You have openings here for different parts and pieces and so on. We have actually covers, as you see here, for the actual remote controls, yes. So pretty fun and exciting and dynamic to be the first into this kind of a category with some lead gear.
Wow, the quad.
You would cover it.
Yes, I would cover it. The latest, the latest.
Batman.
This is really great. John, thank you so much. Dick DeBartolo, man's maddest writer, and the Giz Wiz, One Take Theater here at gizwiz.tv at PhotoPlus Expo. Bye.
That is some great products. First, Joby is really the leader in the extra accessories to pull off those really high action scenarios with
and you know
phones,
I don't know if it was you
everything.
Or maybe one of the editors at Twit that they had I had shown a Joby device to hold a GoPro I think or one of those action cameras and they had mounted it on the side of a motorcycle for their demo video
and
was it you or one of the editors said,
someone,
wait a minute,
Brian,
this is
probably
this is a back road in Petaluma
right. Right, absolutely. I use my Joby phone stand all the time at my desk, especially if I'm sitting down for a really long recording session or a stream that's over 24 hours. And I know I'm going to have my phone locked right here on the computer, and I want to be able to see notifications quickly. I use it all the time. And there's some construction going on right across the street from my house, and I'm going to use that same setup with the suction cup to hopefully get some really cool time lapse of all the construction as well. So I use Joby products all the time. I really like them as a company. Yeah, really, really good. And gosh, those bags, I can't tell you how popular the drone scene is becoming, because it's becoming so affordable to get into. And carrying a drone around, that's a pretty good investment of all that equipment. And so putting it in a nice backpack is fantastic. And Lopro is known for their fantastic camera gear backpacks. So it just makes tons of sense that they would have a great drone backpack. And darn if these aren't some of the most stylish backpacks I've ever seen.
I actually just have a regular backpack that I carry from Lopro, and the stuff is really beautifully made.
It really is. And I've switched to a camera bag for my normal everyday backpack because it's nice. I really like the padded sides, and man, these are some cool looking backpacks.
Yeah, aren't they great?
Wow.
Also, isn't it fascinating that when something new is invented, whole industries come out?
I know. It really is.
After the iPod came out, there were 90 billion people making cases and battery chargers and phones and headphones and microphones. And now I'm suddenly realizing, holy cow. Drones are now a huge industry, and what a clever idea.
Yeah.
Is to ways to carry your drone.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's so funny because, yeah, one company can come out with one product, and all of the accessories around that product that have to be built. I mean, DJI didn't invent the drone, and they weren't the first to the scene, but gosh darn if they're not the biggest, and so many products are handcrafted to hold a DJI drone nowadays.
Yes, yes.
Very, very cool amazing. Stuff. I've been thinking about getting a DJI drone too, because we were really early on the drone stuff at Twit, and it was so fun to try to learn how to fly an actual drone. But those DJI drones, they have the assisted technology so that they use GPS and Wi-Fi to level themselves out. I went out with someone who owned a drone, and they lost the GPS. They're actually from Canada, and they didn't update the software to have American telemetry. And so they started to fly it, and they were flying it like normal, and they couldn't even do it. And I was like, come on, have you never flown a drone without any assistive technology? They couldn't, and they hadn't, and they couldn't. So I've been thinking about getting a DJI drone because there are some really cool shots that can be made.
Yeah, and you live in a place where you can use a drone.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I'm not in New York. Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
But gosh, these backpacks look awesome. $150 for this one, so it's not cheap, but man.
The thing is, you're protecting drones that cost like up to $1,000, right?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, some of the DJI stuff is like $1,500, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah, low end is around $400, and then the high end is, very, 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 very high end. it looks like this one can fit in a Pelican case, which is pretty cool. Is that true? Yeah, wow. This is just awesome. Good find.
Okay.
Cool.
Okay. Now, before we talk about the next thing, just show a picture of, you said you had not heard of the Pinono. The Pinono. Okay. So the Pinono is a 360-degree camera that is shaped like a ball, and the ball contains 36 separate cameras.
Whoa.
Now, you use this camera by throwing it up in the air.
What?
Yes. And at its highest point, it fires all 36 cameras.
Wow.
And then you have a picture all the way around, including somewhere in there is the person who threw the camera in the air. Now, what is fascinating about Pinono is I saw it 3 years ago at CES, and they were closing in on $900,000 on Indiegogo. I believe they said by the end of the day that I was talking to them, they would have their $900,000 for funding. And you could pre-order one for $499. Then at another CES, they were not there. And then in another CES, they were back there, and it was almost ready to be sold. At PhotoPlus Expo in the press room, I see a release. It's out there, except it's not $499. It is $1,499.
Whoa. $1,000 more?
More. So I go down, and the people there, they're young and they're energetic, and I'm talking to the guys, and I said, guys, is it possible this is now $1,499? And he said, no, we can't make it for that. It's $1,999. I know. Well,
for something that the use case is to toss into the air, there goes $2,000.
I know. Yes. And also they said, I think at CES we might have said it was okay to drop it. Don't, because they break. And anyway, so Ray Wong at Mashable has a great video. He actually was brave enough to take one into Central Park. So, and he will also point out some of the bizarre, I mean, I wish these guys success, but you know what I think part of it is, Chad? Part of it, I think the problem is what we were just talking about. You can buy a drone and get
amazing footage that you can control, and you can just get so immaculate. I mean, it looks like you hired a $500,000 rig to fly a helicopter into the air with cameramen, and it cost you $400 to own a DJI.
And so 3 years ago, drones weren't as cheap and as popular as they are now when they started with this. But let's watch Ray's video, because you can see some of the other problems that come up.
And today Ray, I'm checking out the Pinono, a 360-degree camera that's unlike anything out there. The Pinono is a ball-shaped camera about the size of a grapefruit, and it's used to take high-res 360-degree photos. And it's really expensive at $1,500. Unlike other 360-degree cameras, the Pinono has 36 cameras that cover it. Each one is a 3-megapixel camera. When you take a photo, all 36 fire off at once, and then it's stitched together into a 108-megapixel high-res photo. There are a number of ways you can take photos. You can hold it in your hand and then press the button on top. The downside is your hand will be covering all the cameras on the bottom, or you can use an adapter and put it on a tripod, but the adapter will cost you another $35, or you can use a selfie stick that plugs right into the bottom of the camera. This is the best way to take photos, but it will also cost you another $45. The most interesting way to take a photo with the Pinono is by throwing it up in the air. Built-in sensors will detect when it's reached its highest point and then automatically snap a photo. It sounds great on paper until you realize, one, the Pinono is not drop-proof, so if you don't catch it and it falls, it'll likely break, and then you'll be out of $1,500. Two, you have to throw it straight up into the air. Any spin or shake will prevent photos from being taken. And three, the pics aren't as good as when you use a selfie stick. After you've taken a bunch of 360-degree photos, you need to use the app to process them. This involves connecting the Pinono to a smartphone app, downloading the unstitched raw images, uploading them into the cloud, and then waiting for them to stitch and render. Downloading and uploading pics takes only a few seconds, but waiting for your 108-megapixel 360-degree photo to process could take anywhere between 13 to 15 minutes if you have a fast internet connection.
No.
Longer if you have a slower connection. From there, you can view it on the phone app or online. Image quality is so-so. It takes higher quality pics than other 360 cameras that are cheaper, but they can be a hit or a miss. The Pinono comes with 16 gigabytes of internal storage, which is good for about 600 photos. The Pinono is certainly a different type of camera, but I can't wholeheartedly recommend it just yet. It's expensive and it doesn't shoot video. It's a fun camera for the 360 enthusiasts, but everyone else should probably wait until it does more and gets cheaper.
Yeah, there was too
the
many.
Power of Thor.
He's doing some crazy stuff. There's too many asterisks with that problem.
Yes, exactly. And when he's talking about it was only 1500. Now it's 2000 plus 2050. You need the selfie stick. And like he said, not only do you have to throw it up, but you have to throw it straight up. Because if it's turning
it's
in any way,
oh my gosh.
It won't fire because it's going to take blurry pictures. Then they take a long time to load. I don't see it.
Oh my gosh! I mean, it just doesn't make any sense. When I go to this is DJI, and I look at their current stock of cameras. You can get the Phantom 3 Professional with a 4K camera for $1,000.
Oh, my gosh. You know, that's come down a lot already.
Yeah. You could get the new Maverick for $1,000. It doesn't make any sense. It just doesn't add up. And then on top of that, the first gadget that we talked about today was, you know, it's not going to take as high resolution photos, but the Theta was
it's
under 300.
$299.
Yeah.
$299. Yeah.
I don't see a use case where a picture is worth $2,000, where a single 360 high resolution photo is worth $2,000, or, you know, obviously multiple after you bought it.
Right. No, and Ray was very brave. He actually threw it up, and I know where he was standing. That's all bricks where he was on
right.
the ground.
That's a big, that's a big rock that doesn't have.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
So anyway, I love the guys there, but guys, they're talking about version 2 in 2021. I don't know.
I don't know. To me, it would have to cost about the same as the Theta. You know, you have to be in the $300 to $400 area to consider it.
Yeah, and we'd have to have rubber straps all the way around it, so if you did drop it, you weren't out all the money.
Yeah. Yep, I don't see a big use case for that in the future.
Okay, well, then I'll cancel the order. I put one on.
Yeah, you got
I said I have a friend in Dallas who needs one
right.
of these.
You're right. I have his business credit card. Can you charge that one? Okay.
Yeah, right.
Here you go. Yeah, that's a no-no anyway. For the Pinono.
All right, well, those are my gadgets from PhotoPlus Expo, which means I don't even know, because it's November, what. Oh, I know that it's time for Chad's Crappy Corner.
Hopefully the audio will play. There it goes.
You might want it at Chad's Crappy Corner.
Okay.
Get it.
Gotta hide what this is until we explain what's going on. We sent a poll out to our patrons who voted, and man, was it a tight race. Wasn't until about noon today. I almost took a screenshot of it so that it wouldn't move because, oh my gosh, it moved! I should have taken a screenshot of it. Well, this is embarrassing. We had 85 votes, and what was winning when I looked at it was under $5. Right now, it is tied for first.
Oh, okay.
You see, 27 votes, 27 votes for sleeping gadgets. So under $5 is what I bought for.
Okay.
But and so right now it is currently tied with sleeping gadgets. And then cleaning gadgets was very close at 25 votes. So 27.
But you know, you know our audience, Chad. Look at fitness gadgets.
None. No one. No one cared at all about fitness gadgets at all.
At all.
So So under $5 is what won. Now, have you heard of a store called Five Below.
No, but I want to know about it.
Yeah, so this is a store that I thought you would like. There's one near me, and I've seen a few of them around. And it is like a dollar store, except things will be at least $5 or below. So it's not quite a dollar store. It's basically a $5 store. But there's many things that cost a dollar, cost $3. The nice thing about it is that I guess by being able to charge a few extra dollars, it's very nice. If you've ever been inside of a, it's not very nice. It's not like they hand you caviar as you walk in, but it's much nicer than any of the Dollar Tree, Dollar General, 99-cent stores I've ever been in where it's not a great experience. So I have a few photos of what one looks like. You can see, yeah, they have some nice styling on the side. These are wheelbarrows that have all sorts of different things. And
well, you know it's a quality store when the merchandise is rolled out in wheelbarrows.
It's in wheelbarrows. Exactly. They have branded things and name brands that you know of. This is like some Minion bags that you could use for reusable groceries. You have your candy. This is from Halloween, obviously. Here's some My Little Pony toys. And just in general,
that is an enormous store.
Yeah, I feel like it's a much nicer upgrade to a dollar store, but you can still find some nice products. And also for things that you know that don't need to be $20 at a normal Best Buy,
yes,
like headphones.
Yes.
They have a huge headphone section. They have a huge charger section where you know that you're only going to be spending about $5 for those products. So I went over to Five Below because it's $5 and under to find some gadgets. And the first thing I found was Toilet Tunes. I thought this was right up our crappy gadget alley. I've turned it on, oh gosh. So we have Toilet Tunes here, and in order to show it off, I recorded a little bit of a video. And so let's jump in to the video.
Hey, DD, Chad here, and we are in the bathroom. So come into the loo area with me, and we're gonna check out Toilet Tunes. Normally, you're just so bored on the toilet, and there's nothing to do. So now, with Toilet Tunes, you can have some fun and learn at the same time. Looking at the box, this is a product that is 8 years and older. So we should fit. So to start off with Toilet Tunes, there is a start button in the top corner here. You can also turn it off that way. So that now you have. Whoops. Waffles is coming in here. Waffles is curious as well. Waffles, what do you think of Toilet Tunes? Come on. Check out Toilet Tunes. You gonna test it for us? Here we go. We're gonna give you a little bit of heads up. What do you think?
She is scared.
She's kind of freaked out. I don't think there's any flats or sharps.
So the black keys don't work.
Oh, I see. They just painted on.
So let's try to play a tune. Waffles. Waffles, will you help me? Okay, Waffles. Here we go. And we're going to play a tune, a toilet tune. Here we go. Wait. Which pot are you going to use? Here you go. We didn't do that right. It was supposed to be Mary Had a Little Lamb.
Thanks, oh, I thought it was London Bridge.
Cheers. Woo! And that's Toilet Tunes. I believe it was $5. And hopefully we'll be able to find it online. It does require 3 AAA batteries, not included. Bye bye. And endless entertainment, maybe Mozart. The next Mozart will first use toilet tunes. Bye bye.
Okay, so toilet tunes cost me $5. Found it online.
You know, I see it. It's on Amazon.
Right, it is. And it's for $8.97. So find a Five Below near you. Bye bye. Oh, it was on. Obviously, you probably wouldn't use your fingers with this, but it's definitely nice and soft, so any kid could use it. And hopefully, especially if maybe you're potty training, or hopefully they're potty trained by 8, but it's definitely something to keep, I would say, children or kids entertained while at the loo.
Oh, you know, I was worried because it says you make the sounds, and I thought, what kind of a gross thing is this?
You record it at the toilet.
You make the sounds, and then I said, keyboard, I'm relieved.
Right, definitely. Right. So it's a little keyboard that, you know, plays some tunes while at the toilet. So hopefully... Right.
And it does take batteries. I noticed on Amazon it says, batteries included? No. Does it need batteries? No.
What?
But obviously
it does. It definitely needs batteries. And they are not included. I had to use my own batteries for toilet tunes. Don't know if I'll be keeping it around for very long.
No, just for company.
Yeah, right. But it does. I mean, it is actual notes, which is good. You could play Mary Had a Little Lamb if you want. The box behind it isn't really helping me out. I just realized there's 3 sharps and 3. This is not how a piano works. It's normally 2 and then 3. That's that's misprinted. I don't think that exists on a keyboard. 3 sharps and flats and 3 sharps and flats. I don't
think it was invented by a musician, to tell you the truth.
I don't think it was either. Okay, so that is Toilet Tunes. You can get it online. Prime shipping for $8.
Or, oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Or you could head to a Five Below near you and try to pick one up yourself. And that is it. Toilet Tunes. Okay.
Excellent.
Moving on to Dick's Gadget Warehouse.
They're geeky and they're goofy. Together they are loopy. When gadgets pass away, he takes them out to play in Dick's Gadget Warehouse.
All right, we have our letter is, hi Dick and Chad. I saw you didn't have any viewer videos left, so I have created my very first one. Here is my video of a very useful wireless light switch. I hope you enjoy it. And I'm going to do something different, Chad. Can we show a picture of what this gadget is before we see the video?
Yeah, let me find it.
Because I put a link to it there. So this is a fun warehouse thing because it's a gadget that doesn't exist right now, but after we show Michael's video. So I didn't realize at first. I wasn't quite sure what he was doing. So the gadget that he's talking about is in 2 pieces, the light switch and that second gadget that is on the ceiling. And now you'll see exactly how it works in Michael's video.
Hi, Dick and Chad. My name is Michael. I'm from Maine. First, I would like to say that you guys do an awesome job. My daughter and I look forward to watching your episode every week.
Thanks.
It's a little dark in here. The reason for that is the gadget that I would like to show you, which is a wireless light switch. And this is what it is. It just goes in your ordinary light socket, and then you have your bulb on the other end. The reason I needed such a gadget was because this porch has outlets along the walls, and that one light fixture. While the light switch for that is in the house, which ties in both the light and the outlets. Well, I need to have that light switch on at all times due to the fact that we have a freezer on this porch, and when we do laundry, we need the washing machine to work. So in order to do that, was this wireless switch that can still turn on and off the light without having this light on 24/7. Now inside here is a 9-volt battery, which I've replaced once in the last 2 years, and it works fairly well. I bought this in 2014. At the time, we were living in an apartment that didn't have a light switch in our bedroom, so I used this inside a lamp and a light switch by the door, so we can still have light. Bought on Amazon, paid around $19 for it. I just checked, and it's no longer available. It was manufactured by Zenith. They do have other alternatives with, instead of the old-fashioned toggle switch, there's the square one. They have that. They also have ones that you plug in the outlet instead of having the socket. But yeah, works pretty well. Of course, if you flick it real fast, sometimes it doesn't work. Sometimes it does. But yeah, that's that. Nice gadget that works. Well, thank you for your time. Have a great show. Bye.
Thank you so much. It's one of those gadgets that just really fulfills a headache. Whoops, sorry. We're going back to the warehouse. Sorry, I didn't mean to go back to the warehouse like that. So I've got something very similar in my studio, because reaching down and flicking a switch or needing to deal with power management in a situation where the house wasn't designed for what you needed to do is such a pain. So I could really see that that this would help out a lot.
Yeah, so the light switch has no wiring whatsoever.
Right. It was hard to tell. It looked like it was built into the wall.
So you just stick it anywhere on the wall where you wish there was a light switch. And then you put the second screw-in part up in a fixture, take the bulb out, put that in, put the bulb in, and then you have control over that bulb from a light switch that you can install anywhere. And by the way, before I forget, his name is Michael Gendron, G-E-N-D-R-O-N, and he sent us a couple of links so that now – there's, I think he paid like $20. It looks like it's almost $10 more now.
Right,
but there's a toggle switch version of it, and the same thing. You just stick that on a wall, and that's powered by a 9-volt battery. And then, of course, the second thing is powered by your AC. But it is a great way to add an on-off switch. And I was just thinking, if you have a kid who can't reach a light switch, you know, you can put it
perfect
really low in their bedroom,
or even a grandparent or someone who's in a wheelchair. I mean,
yeah, you can relocate the light switch anywhere without an electrician. All you need is someone who can go up and screw the bulb part in, and then have a way to control it from any way you want, high, low, or on a wall
in
without
between.
Switch. Yeah, or in between.
That's great. I think this is a fantastic gadget and easy DIY, do it at home, solution, which is great.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much.
So, Michael, thank you. And two of our people who always send in video sent in more, but it was fun to have someone new sending in a video. So if you haven't sent in a video at all, We now have a video to fall back on from people who have had multiple videos on the show. But we love it when someone new can send in a video. And if possible, to shoot it horizontally. and just 2 to 3 minutes, like Michael did, put it on YouTube, put it in as unlisted. That way, only people with the link can view it. And if we show it on the show, Michael will get December Mad, one of those 30-some-odd-year-old Alfred E. Newman posters, and is now officially part of Giz Wiz Biz fame.
Part of the legacy. The legacy of Giz Wiz.
The legacy of Giz Wiz.
And email it. Sorry, I don't think I showed the email.
And I didn't say it. So put it on YouTube. Email us the link. Mail at gizwiz.tv. And hopefully we'll have something new from a new viewer, from someone who hasn't sent a video before by next week. Or we can fall back onto one of my videos or one of our repeat viewer video senders. Mail at gizwiz.tv.
What,
TV.
Yeah. Moving on to the letter.
The letter.
By the way, looks like we got a link to Sears where it is for $23, and you may be able to pick one up at a local
Sears. That almost looks like the one that...
Exactly, the one that he has. It's a Zenith brand, even.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
So
there you go, and it's just $3 more than he paid years ago.
Yeah, so I think that's a nice option. So thanks, Mars Worm for the link to Sears, so you could check it out there.
Excellent. Our letter is from Brian Harada, H-A-R-A-D-A. Hi, Dick and Chad. I'm a longtime listener. I love your show. I heard you mention dyslexia a couple of times, and I thought I'd share this recent find. This is a font that makes it easier for dyslexics to read, and it really works. There are even ways to set your browser to use this font instead of the web page's recommended font. I hope this helps even a few people out there who struggle with dyslexia. Thanks for sharing. Keep up the great show, Brian Harada. And let's go to the link. The link will be on our website.
Yes, and I've actually seen this, opendyslexic.org, and what it does is it sort of bolds the bottom and adds strokes to the bottom of letters.
Oh, I see.
Right, and it makes it a little bit easier to determine different letters. It uses a few different tricks. One is this is a very different font, so your brain has to think of the letter a little bit differently than it's used to, which helps. And also, the difference in characters can be much more different near the bottom than at the top. So it kind of adds significance to the bottom of the letter, which helps. I've seen this before. It probably helps. I haven't used it long enough to determine if it really made a difference for me. But I have seen it before, and it's always good to tell people about, there is a font out there that you can try to use if you're dyslexic. And
it's called Dyslexic Open.
Open
Dyslexic.
and you can download it now, right there. right exactly. There. So
and it's free, I assume.
It's
right?
Free, yeah. And this is an open source font, so anyone can use it. Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I haven't used it for extended periods of time to figure out if it actually helps. Well, the best thing to probably do would be to print a book in it and then allow myself to read it, or maybe download an e-book and try to change the font to this so that I could read over an extended period of time. because normally if I'm just browsing a page real fast, you know, nothing really crops up. But yeah, absolutely. So that is Open Dyslexic, and I think the first time I saw this was, gosh, 5 years ago, 6 years ago?
Oh, my gosh. Oh, okay. It's been around a while.
It may not have been this Open Dyslexic font, but I do remember hearing and seeing about a font made to help correct some of the problems with dyslexia. So
perfect.
Yeah.
Brian, thank you. Thank you for the letting us know about it.
And with that, I think we have another thank you to give to our patrons. This show is completely independent. It's just me and Dick and Josh and Andy, who sometimes edits. the team's getting larger. It is hard to say we're independent when we got about four people working on it. This is it. That team really only works on the Giz Wiz. So if you like the Giz Wiz, please support. Patreon.com/GizWiz is the way to help out. And we really, really, really appreciate our patrons. Thank you so much for your generosity. Thank you so much for supporting the Giz Wiz and allowing us to continue. If you are a patron, see this Choose November's crappy theme. You could have been some of the people who voted to make the theme so tight. It was such a tight race. Right at the end, it was tied. So next month, you can decide on that. And thank you guys so, so, so much for your support. We have over 290 patrons right now. So thank you so much. And even just a small amount helps. It's absolutely fantastic. If you enjoy the Giz Wiz, we do have a little bit of a schedule change for you
right
coming
now.
Up. So thank you. Sorry about that. And next week, we will be recording on Wednesday. The week after
actually, that. Actually, yes, 3 weeks in a row.
Yeah, 3 weeks in a row. So the 10th will be recorded on the 9th. The 17th will be recorded on the 16th. And the 24th will be recorded on the 23rd. All the way until after Thanksgiving, we're going to be recording on Wednesday. So set your calendars accordingly.
Yes.
If you want to watch
it. And also, if you check gizwiz.tv, the bar there, I always update that with when the next show is.
Right here, this red,
red
bar right there.
Exactly. And Chad, you're forgetting something.
What?
You're forgetting that we are revealing.
Oh, yes! Oh, I'm so excited. Okay, gizwiz.biz.
What the heck is it?
What the heck was it?
And the new what the heck is it?
Okay. I really don't know what that was. It looked like some sort of clamp. Did I ever say what it was? Correctly?
You got close, I think. Anyway, 10 people got it correct. It is the Ease Out Broken Bulb Remover. You stick that yellow thing into... That's when the bulb breaks off and it leaves the bottom of the bulb, the metal piece, in the socket.
Oh.
Shut the power off, stick the yellow thing in, squeeze so that the rubber part grabs onto the metal part that's stuck in the socket, and then you unscrew it. And a hint from one of the winners who said, you can do the same job with a cut potato.
Oh.
Doesn't seem as neat as this. And that little thing, the plastic shield is if any pieces of glass fall on it, right. Exactly. That will protect your hand from a lot of people. Almost 20 people said it's for changing light bulbs, but there's no way to change a light bulb with this because all you could do is hold the screw part and screw the big part of the light bulb into a socket, which is not going to work. So it's just a light bulb remover. And then we picked 27 people for the funny things. Ice cream holder, the plastic thing is so it doesn't drip on your hand. Paintbrush holder, paint doesn't drip on your hand. A bobby hair straightener, let you recork a bottle of wine.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah, a flare holder, manual nose trimmer with a built-in sneeze guard, bag crimper. It almost could be a bag crimper. A new duck call with a built-in saliva guard. A lot of funny things.
I like the nose trimmer.
Right. A dollar store version of the Star Wars lightsaber.
My first lightsaber.
Yes, exactly. Yes, you're right. A core remover for short pineapples. The clear disc keeps the juice off your hands. And this is funny. Dog medicine adapter. You pop it in his hand, and then you open it, and that holds his jaws open, and you drop the pill down the middle. anyway, some very funny answers.
That's great.
Yeah. So,
okay. Wow. I didn't know. Now I know. It is a broken bulb remover.
Over. And the new game is at the top of that page.
Okay. So here it is, the gadget that we're all wondering what it is. And this is the whole gadget. This is not
this
just
is the
a piece.
Whole gadget.
Yes. This is as everything.
If you went out to buy it, this is what you would be getting.
I think that you put your finger right through the middle, and this is a way to paint your nails with polka dots. You get the perfect circles through here. That's where the paint goes, and your finger goes right through the middle. It's simple. The polka dot finger creator. It's simple and short name, as you know. There's 12 Mad Magazines for correct answers. Normally, Dickie D is generous. He gives a few extra out. And 24 for funny, hilarious, and clever answers. So get on over to gizwiz.biz, click the What the Heck Is It banner, and get guessing, and you too will have another Mad Magazine signed by Dick himself. That's hilarious.
Yeah, you'll be playing for February Mad, and we're doing something different in the February Mad. I'm doing the takeoff, a 6-page takeoff on the movie Sully. And we've done this twice before where we are timing it to come out when the DVD comes out, because the DVD, the company said they're trying to get on store shelves for the holidays. And the good thing about the movie Sully is, even if you didn't see the movie,
you know about it.
Everybody in the world knows the story.
Right. It's so, the downed plane in the Hudson.
Exactly.
Everybody knows about it.
And John said, you know, you'll have a ball with this. And he said, if you want to put your boat in it, you know the Hudson River, do what you want with it. So I had a lot of fun with Sully.
Do you write the text? And then exactly. Do you kind of give hints about, like, okay, put a boat in the background here?
You know what? John will say, you know, I said to John, I have different ways to do the splash, and I described all the ways. And he said, well, you know what? I want it to be a very big kind of expanse, so that when you open the page, you'll see the big airplane. He said, so give me enough stuff so that – so I said, I'll give you people talking on boats. I'll give you the people in New Jersey making comments about it. I said, if the splash is big enough, I'll have someone on the George Washington Bridge trying to collect the airfare because the airplane basically went so close to the bridge.
It's going
to
be like a Where's Waldo.
Yes, exactly.
Like big old
it's a two-page splash.
That's
with
great.
Lots of stuff in it.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it. Okay, well, if you want a signed copy, get a guessing over at gizwiz.biz. While you're there, Dick has written up articles about each of the gadgets that we cover on the show. If you want to watch the show live, you can do so at gizwiz.tv. If you don't catch the show live, you can also download the episodes from there or subscribe so they get hand-delivered to you by robots. And that about wraps it up for this episode of the Giz Wiz. We'll see you next week.
I'll be here.